Well, it's been often said that the relationship between the United States and China will determine the future of the 21st century. The two big power rivals are walking many fault lines, from China's military build-up, disputed territorial claims, and an uneasy economic partnership. The incoming Trump administration has put a big target on China. The nominee for Secretary of State says the US should block China's claims to islands in the South China Sea. Rex Tillerson says China's island building is like Russia's annexation of Crimea. At the same time, Donald Trump is talking of a trade war with Beijing. In a moment, we look at what that could mean for Australia caught in the crossfire. First, though, here's a little of what Rex Tillerson had to say.
China has emerged as an economic power in global trade, and our interactions have been both friendly and adversarial. China's island building in the South China Sea is an illegal taking of disputed areas without regard for international norms. China's economic and trade practices have not always followed its commitments to global agreements. It steals our intellectual property and is aggressive and expansionist in the digital realm. China has proven a willingness to act with abandon in the pursuit of its own goals, which at times has put it in conflict with American interest. We have to deal with what we see, not what we hope. The island building in the South China Sea itself, in many respects, in my view, building islands and then putting military assets on those islands is akin to Russia's taking of Crimea. We're going to have to send China a clear signal that first, the island building stops, and second, your access to those islands is also not going to be allowed.
Well, to Donald Trump, China is an economic bully and a cheat, and it is stealing American jobs. He's vowing to take Beijing on, threatening big tariffs on Chinese goods, which would price some Chinese goods out of the American market. He's also calling China out on its currency, saying Beijing keeps it low to get an unfair trade advantage. China, for its part, would hit back with measures of its own. And in the middle, Australia. China is our biggest trading partner, and the US our closest security ally. To discuss a potential trade war, I was joined earlier by economists and China experts James Lawrence-Essen and Tim Harcourt. James Lawrence-Essen, Tim Harcourt, lovely to have you with us. James, the question everyone's really wondering now is, will Trump do it? Will he make good on what he is threatening against China?
6 months ago, I would have said no, but everything I've seen since the election says yes, or we're getting closer. It's not unavoidable, but we're getting closer. You know, he has stacked his advisory team with China hawks. Mm-hmm. A lot of his appointments to cabinets have been China hawks as well. So it's going to be, it's not inevitable, but I do worry it could happen.
To the extent that he's been threatening, will he whack on the 45% tariffs in some cases? Will he call China, brand China, a currency manipulator? Because that's going to have implications as well.
Yeah, so let's be clear. He can't do a 45% tariff without breaching WTO rules. So the US is a WTO member, so that would be illegal under those rules. There are domestic laws that Trump can use without getting approval from Congress to put a 15% tariff for a period of up to 150 days on Chinese imports. Still, it would be in breach of the US's international obligations. So you would expect he wouldn't do it, but, you know, from what we've seen from Trump so far, he may.
Tim Harcourt, do you share that same view? Do you expect him to go through with it? And what would the Chinese do in retaliation?
I think James is right. I mean, trade laws are made in Congress, even though trade rhetoric comes from the Oval Office. So at the end of the day, you've got to give the president fast-track authority to rip up a trade deal or make a new one. I think to some extent, the actions by Trump in telling Toyota, General Motors to stay in Michigan and not go to Mexico will be most of his trade policy. He'll use the bully pulpit to threaten and goad American companies rather than using formal trade legislation, which, as James says, is WTO inconsistent.
In the short term, what impact would it have? Of course, you know, the US buys a lot more from China than China buys from the United States. So what impact would it have? Would it bring the jobs back to America that Trump has said is his aim?
The one thing that Donald Trump has managed to do so far is he's managed to unite the economics profession against his policies, getting all economists to agree. I mean, there might be a short-term sugar hit with some confidence in markets and so on, but at the end of the day, trade sanctions will hurt American workers and Walmart consumers. Joan Robinson, the famous British economist, said that, you know, putting on trade sanctions is like putting rocks in your own harbour. And in the long term, the economic implications would probably hurt America.
But he's not thinking about the long term, is he, James? He's thinking about the short term. The slogan was Make America Great Again. The fear that he has been talking about is that China steals American jobs, it manipulates its currency to keep it low, to get a trade advantage, it's selling cheap goods to the US, it's taking away US manufacturing jobs. In the short term, would he get the sugar hit that he's looking for?
Oh, look, I think he'd struggle to even get that. The bottom line is trade is mutually beneficial, win-win. The only reason Chinese consumers buy American products and American consumers buy Chinese products is because they want it. So if you put tariffs in place, then you immediately go from a win-win situation to a lose-lose situation. So he may win the political rhetoric battle in the short run, but I think the economics would bite hard, and it would bite pretty quickly.
Tim, what could China do in retaliation? Of course, it doesn't have the arsenal that the US has when it comes to what it could do in a trade war, but it could be strategic. It could go after some big contracts, Boeing, for instance, and others. Would you see the strategic approach from China?
Oh, definitely. I think, you know, the Chinese economy is still run by fiat. It's run by the party. And ultimately, if you're an American company like a Boeing or an Apple looking to expand your investment into China, you'd be concerned because China could easily retaliate. China could easily go after America's competitors. And, you know, interestingly enough, you know, China is moving its economy from being a nation of shippers, being export dependent, to a nation of shoppers, where it's really domestic consumption and investment, which is good news for Australia. But ultimately, it's not looking for American investment like it would have been 15 years ago. So they've got plenty of tools in their arsenal, and they're not as dependent on American investment as they used to be.
Is China manipulating its currency? That's a claim that's been made a lot in the past, but the currency has also climbed. Some would say it's even overvalued. Is China manipulating the currency to keep it low and get that advantage anymore?
Well, we have an answer to that question from the US Treasury just 3 months ago.
So it doesn't meet the criteria.
Exactly. Every 6 months, the US Treasury is required to produce a report that analyses other countries' currency policies. The US Treasury very clearly said China was fine. So it would be an extraordinary situation 3 months later if the president instructed the Secretary of Treasury to declare that China was a currency manipulator, in contrast to all the evidence which says that it's not.
What would this mean for Australia? We can talk about the two big dogs having the fight here, but Australia potentially caught in the middle of this, our biggest trading partner. We run a surplus with China rather than the United States. Our trade is the opposite direction there. Would Australia feel the pinch if the two big powers got into a tit-for-tat trade war?
If it was an all-out trade war that really crippled the international trading system, that'd be bad news for any open economy, including Australia. What could happen as an alternative scenario is that China may regard Australia as a stable, reliable trading partner, very important for food security and energy security, which is what they need, and that what Beijing never wants is instability.
As Tim said, last year, for example, 70% of China's growth came from domestic consumption. You know, the idea that China's an export-led growth economy now is in fact very out of date. China's driven by domestic consumption, domestic investment. I share a tinge of optimism as well, in the sense that if things did slow down in China, you can expect the Chinese government to have a response. And history shows that that response will probably be in the form of increased infrastructure spending. Well, that requires a lot of inputs, and in particular, Australian coal and Australian iron ore. So it may not be the end of the world for Australia.
Just a final thought from you, Tim, because you also watched the geopolitical situation. What are the risks here? We're seeing a lot more tough talk coming out of the incoming Trump administration when it comes to China's aspirations and territorial demands in the South China Sea. What is the potential for that to have a knock-on effect as well for the economy of the region, especially if that got to a tipping point?
I think with Brexit, with Trump, with a lot of the big economic headlines that we've seen in the past 12 months, the implications have been more geopolitical. I thought the economic implications of Brexit were overblown, but the only person really barracking for it, apart from Nigel Farage, would have been Vladimir Putin. And I think it's the same case here, where you've got the issues between Russia and China and the United States and the implications in the South China Sea, for instance, basically spilling over into the economic sphere. I don't think some of the economic fears that we've got in terms of Trump and trade may not come to pass, particularly for Australia, bit of geopolitical things got hot, that could almost be a negative externality into the trade and the economic relationship that's so important to Australia. Mm.
So much to discuss. We don't even have time to get into the Trans-Pacific Partnership, which is also at the moment, wavering. So we'll discuss that another time. Tim Harcourt, James Lawrence, and thank you both for coming in.
Thanks, Dan.
Pleasure.